Hello, my name is Justin Hickman, and it is Thursday, July 6th, 2023. And today, it's been a while since I streamed last, and today I would like to make a little change to what I'm doing just to keep things a little bit more fresh. We'll get back to the make an app streams later, but today let's make a widget. And today we're going to start looking at creating a color picker. I'm not entirely sure what that's going to look like. I think the Domino team is planning on creating one, but I think because I've created one of these in the past, it would be a simple one for me to start looking at because this one is going to be a composite widget that's going to basically hold other types of widgets. So let's go ahead and get started. So today I pulled up one of my old projects in IntelliJ. This is the one that I was doing a while back with the data table and the live grid stuff that I was doing before. Figure I might as well just create a new component here for the color picker. If you've ever looked at the Chrome debugger inspector, every one of these styles that has a color, you have the ability to click on it and modify that. So for example, changing the background color could look like this, and you see that it has this hue picker right here, and this is an HSV picker. Even though it's coming out as hex, it's really an HSV picker. Because if we take a look, that one doesn't actually have it, does it? There might be a HSV picker somewhere. Let me do a quick Google or DuckDuckGo search for that. Let's take a look. So yeah, here's HSV. So this is the hue, saturation, and value. So the way this works, you have this hue picker right here, which goes 0 to 360 degrees. Even though 360 ends up being zero because it wraps around. So if I set it to 242, for example, or let's 90. And that's going to be this. But now with the saturation and value, it's basically got this little gradient area. And I don't know if you've ever played around with the colors, but basically saturation goes left to right from 0 to 100%. And this color picker is a little laggy. It might be because of the ads. I'm not sure, but yeah, that's a little laggy. You can see that after I click on it, takes a little bit for it to pop over there. If I come to this side, I'm only looking at the horizontal aspect. You can see that we go from 0 to 100%. And then the value is the exact same thing. So if I, let me do 50% so we can see it. So if we go to 0%, oh, that's interesting. I guess this picker doesn't allow you to have 50% there. And this one actually goes outside of the bounds. It's not a great color picker. I mean, it does its job for sure, but obviously we're highlighting an area that's not actually in the color zone here. But you can see that we have zero for the value, and then, I lose the ability to drag. There we go. And up to 100% on the other value. So 0, 0, 100, 100. Pretty simple. And of course, all of these can be converted into their relative RGB and the hex values as well. And we'll get to those as well. But today we're just going to look at the initial leaf nodes of the composition of this picker, because obviously we have two different controls here. We have this guy right here, which chooses the hue. And technically, this has the ability to be formed in its own. And it can also be vertical or horizontal. So if I come back over to this guy, you can see that this one is horizontal. So it might be nice to have it configurable for vertical and horizontal. But today we're going to be doing this in Domino UI, and we are going to investigate, that is not the right screen. We're going to investigate how to work with the draggable stuff, because I know that if I go to the demo of Domino UI, we come down to components and there should be a drag. And is it not there? Samples. Drag and drop. And it's just not in alphabetical order. So drag and drop, you can see that we have these draggables, and we have the, I don't know, it might be just Chrome. I think it's possibly due to the stream closed captioning. For some reason, in the other Chrome side, it seems to take a lot of CPU to convert all of my audio into text. But we can see that we have the ability to drag and drop these. If we take a look at the code for this, I mean, this one just uses like drag source and drop zones. We might have to do something special for this, because we're not exactly having the ability to drag from one place to another and it just snaps into a place. What we're wanting is some ability to drag this and render this absolute position within that container, and capture the other percentage of the other distance, and then we can calculate what the other degrees is from 0 to 359, I guess, because at the very top it'll be 0. So let's go ahead and do that. And I don't think I can hear my music anymore. Hopefully that's not too loud. All right, so let's go ahead and come in here. And I did play around with some of this stuff, because I am actually going to throw this directly into the Domino UI project. I probably should create a branch for that. So let me go ahead and do that real quick on the other screen. So source, Domino, and this is Domino UI. So let me check out, create new branch. I know that you can't see this. My cords are getting in the way. Oops, hitting my keyboard. I am going to create this one as color picker. Only because I am doing this within the same project. And I did this through a symlink. The only reason I did that is because with super dev mode, the code server seems to really need this to be in the same reactor. So whenever I'm running the Maven stuff for the code server, where's my running config? So the code server here, it wasn't able to pick up any of the changes that I made unless I created the POM that way. So, I mean, I could have probably done it a different way, but this seems to work for me. And I was able to pull up the project appropriately. So let me go ahead and close that out. And here we want to column apply, and we are going to do hue picker. Hue picker, column. There we go. And then we can do column.append, not apply, but append child, word.create, And I'm just going to do Hue Picker as the title of this guy. And probably going to have a horizontal one and a vertical one. So let's go ahead and append a child layout. Flex layout. It's been a while since I've written a UI. Set direction, top bottom, append child, label.create, and let's just call this one horizontal. And we're going to do the same with a vertical. I just type vertispan, vertical. And let's go ahead and refresh that browser window just to see that it actually created that card with the other couple of labels inside of it. And it did. Of course, it's on the other, it's centered, but that's fine. All right, so let's go ahead and create a hue picker component. So the way the Domino UI project is oriented right now, you basically have Domino UI, and then all of the other components seem to be in their own package. So I'll probably just create a color picker package. And I already created a CSS file, and this one is located inside of the resources under the public CSS color picker. And that one, I was able to get it to be included in the surrounding CSS with the minification. Oh, thanks for the follow, Zavi Boy. I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce it. So then let's go back to the color picker, and let's create a new class, hue picker. Nope. Are we doing hue? Yeah, we're doing hue. Because eventually we're going to have a HSV picker as well. And here I am not entirely sure what we're going to do. We could have a base class of some sort of color picker base class, but I may just do base domino element for now. I think that's correct. There we go. It's been a while since I've created one of these. But that one should work. In this particular case, I'm thinking the structure of it. Let me see if I can just do a multi-line comment here. I'm going to have some sort of container. And that one's going to be relative position, and it's going to try to fill the parent possibly. I could probably set a specific width of the track, but I am not sure, because if you, let's pull that up again. So this track can be any width. I mean, doesn't make sense to have this very tall. That would look kind of weird, especially with this little drag handle. Not sure if I want to have a circle. Circle's kind of nice. I mean, especially for this area. But I think for this one, the one that we saw on this other website, having it more rectangular. I know that it has rounded corners, but a rectangular one probably makes a little bit more sense on this, because you only need the single pixel in there that represents the value of that component. Okay. Oh, stupid ad. Thought that was going to actually play. All right, so this one's going to be a position relative. And then we're going to have, it's hard to explain, but there's basically like a constraint box. Whenever I drag this little component, let me zoom in, is going to be in a constraint. Notice how it's on the outside of the other track. So we need to be able to constrain this dragger a little bit larger than the other track itself. I mean, I could do some absolute position where we're like outside of it, but I want to make sure that we have the larger div that's holding everything, including the other dragger handle, for spacing purposes. We don't want to deal with clipping of the overflow. So here we're going to have some sort of constraint box. I know that I'm writing HTML in here, but it's more of a guideline. So this is the constraint box. Basically everything is going to be held inside of this. This one will be absolute positioned, 0, 0 for the top and left, and the 100% width, 100% height. So this one will fill this parent, and inside of here, we will have another div, most likely, for the dragger, drag handle. And I'm just gonna close that off. And we're also going to have another div right here. I'm just gonna close this one off because there's nothing inside of it. This is going to be the hue slider background or track. So let's go ahead and do that. Domino element, HTML div element, root. Does that return? Yeah, it does return a domino element. And then we can return root.element, right? And this can be final. All right, so then inside of this, let's go ahead and add the other divs. Isn't it letting me do the auto import here? I'm not sure which one to actually do. Maybe that one. These we'll have to deal with, but let's go ahead and at least add some sort of style. I know that we're going to be doing the CSS, but I don't want to deal with that right now. We can do that once we figure out what the CSS is going to be. So we'll just do inline styles for now. And append child, we're gonna have the other div inside of that. So we have the outer one. This is the constraint div. This is the drag handle. And then we're going to have another div here for the background slider. And we can probably do something with this. We might as well do the CSS on this one, because this one's not gonna really change. And what are the color choices here, or the default? I know that this is going to be changing in the next version of Domino, because the next version, Domino 2, is going to be the styling, theming, CSS changes. I'm probably going to have some sort of, I know that this does take in more bytes in the output, but I'm going to have some sort of prefix on these. DUI color picker is going to be my prefix for all of these. I'm going to have hue container. Yeah, might as well just do these all. I know. I said we're not going to, but it's fine. Constraint. If we were doing this in SAS, I would be doing the nested class definitions here. Don't need that anymore because we changed the naming scheme. I can change these names later. All right. And of course the minification, until we actually have styles in here, it's actually going to get removed because nothing actually is done with these. So let's come back over here and let's go ahead and add CSS name. I wonder if we should create a styles class or, probably. I'm just gonna create a quick interface for styles. And this is going to be package private. And I'm just gonna put constants in here. I don't like magic strings. Try not to use magic strings as much as possible. Where's my style? There it is. I don't need the static, not being in an interface at least, and final of course. All right, so this is going to be constraint, dragger, slider, BG. Back over here, we have the styles, and this is going to be the slider background. And this is going to be styles container. Probably need to change the other names of these constants. That's fine for now. Not until we have the other ones in here. And this one is going to be the dragger. I mean, I could pull some of these out. I might end up doing that, but I might do a hue picker constructor here and grab the other components because we will need access to those at some point. But let's start thinking about the CSS for these. So let's come back over to the CSS. And the container is going to be position relative with 100%. Let's just do a flex one, just in case it's inside of a flex box. Maybe not. We're going to have to figure out vertical versus horizontal. So let's develop this as a horizontal hue picker first. And then we can determine the rest later. All right, so for the constraint, this one we will have a height of 100%, width 100%, because this one will fill this container. This one's going to be position absolute, left 0, top 0. And probably going to have some sort of offset. This is going to be based upon the dragger, but we'll come back to that once we actually see some of this stuff. All right, so let's do the slider background as well. So the background for this, it's going to be a linear gradient. And again, we are just doing the horizontal. And this one's going to be interesting, but it's HSL 0, 100%, 50%. I did grab these from a website. Can't remember where I grabbed it from. But basically creating the appropriate gradient for this hue picker that stretches across the entire color spectrum. Last one at the 360. We have 100% and 50 again. And this needs a... I think I have enough parents in there. Quite a few parents. All right, so that is basically the hue range. And it does look correct if you take a look at this. This is basically just telling the start and stop. This is the hue, this is the saturation, and this is the value, or the lightness. Because this is HSL, hue, saturation, and lightness, I believe. Yeah. And all of these are just 50% lightness, 100% saturation, and that's just stopping at, along the way, through the 360 degrees. And we need some extra stuff. So that is just the background color, but we also need to do position absolute, because this is going to be absolute position in behind it. Let's go ahead and add a border radius. No border radius. 24 pixels height. Right now, because we're only doing the horizontal, this one's going to be hard-coded for now. I don't know if we're going to have that later or not. Width 100%. Let's go ahead and put a border on this. With, so this is basically black with a 10% opacity. Alpha. And I think by default, everything inside of Domino components are going to be box sizing border box. I could be wrong. All right, so then the other dragger. This one's going to be an inline block. And let's just make that one white for now. And this one's going to have a cursor pointer because of the fact that it's going to be a draggable. We need to be able to set its cursor. And its position is going to be absolute. So make sure that our Z index is such a way that it's above the sibling elements. I don't know if we need three, probably just do a one. And we don't really know the dragger size. Let's do, what is our border? 8 pixels. That is kind of thick. Let's just add some stuff. Left is going to be zero, so we're going to automatically set the left to zero. Do I have the ability to pull up a, yeah, this one has one too. Nice. So this one also has a hue picker, so we're basically going to be starting this on the other left side. So absolute position, the dragger is going to be left zero, and of course in code it'll be able to change the position of it. Top is going to be some sort of offset. -8 pixels. And this is where I would typically use, oh, I can't use that kind of comment. I've been doing a lot of SAS recently. So you can do like line comments like that. But typically I would do something with a CSS resource or something. That way I can have variables in here. So the height is going to basically be the dragger size, right? And the width, dragger size. All right, and this is also going to have a before pseudo element, dragger before. And it's just going to have an empty content position absolute. And straight offset. This is only so that we can have the dragger being a little bit outside of the constraint area. All right. Border, 1 pixel solid, RGBA, and this is going to basically be the same as what we had above for the other border. First, we're just going to do this as a circle, and then we will fine tune it to be more of an oval shape, maybe. just double check these numbers. So the dragger offset, this one's actually going to be negative 10 pixels. The constraint offset is negative 8. All right, so then the constraint box, ignored this before, but let's go ahead and put a margin top. And this is going to be the dragger offset, which is negative 10 pixels. We can probably just use variables for this, but I just want to put this in place for now. That way it can actually be set in the widget itself, which is actually a lot nicer. I'm just double checking for my notes. That should be correct. So I am going to go to the terminal. I'm just going to run Maven prepare package, and that'll do the CSS minification. And that should make it available to the super dev mode. And that is taking a little bit to compile classes. Yeah, I'm having that issue with the slow cursor again. I think it's OBS. I need to check to see if there's any updates on OBS, because every time I open or run OBS, it really kills my the CPU, or I don't know. Eh, it's taking a little bit, huh? There we go. There we go. You can see that it merged the CSS, and let's go ahead and go back to Chrome. Let me close some extra tabs. We probably don't need this anymore because there are other examples, at least from what I've seen. Probably still need that one. Need that. Let's come over here, refresh. And this should, I'm only looking in specifically for the CSS to make sure that it's actually loaded. We'll check the actual usage of it here in a little bit, but we might have to run this twice because it did the compile. But let me see. I want to go to network CSS. Let's take a look at the components minification and dragger. Yeah, see, this doesn't have the updated. I eliminated that one, so let's go ahead and empty cache and reload. Let's take a look at it now. Hopefully it has the updated dragger. Yep, there it is. So the DUI color picker hue dragger before, after, blah, 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 blah. All right, so it's got all of this stuff now. So now let's go ahead and add that component in our demo. And get rid of that. So I go ahead and minimize this stuff. Color picker, this is the demo. So here, let's go ahead and append child new. Actually, to stick with the theme of the other components in Domino, let's use a static create method. And then we'll change like the other value and stuff later once we actually get something working. Just want to see what this looks like in the HTML side. And there we go. Not bad for the initial go at it, right? I don't know what the crap that is, but let's go ahead and inspect that. That's actually not bad. All right, so we have the container. Can I highlight this stuff? No, I cannot. Oh, so this one, I probably need to specify a width or a height, I mean. So we can, the way I typically do this is to modify the HTML directly. So let's just do like a 50 pixels. All right, you can see now it's got 50 pixels. We have our constraint box. Might want to change the background color to that way we can see it a little bit. All right, so that one does encompass everything. Probably need to have an overflow hidden. That way it clips anything that's outside of its bounds, because we really don't want elements to be leaking out any. All right, so the constraint box, it does look like we have have a top margin. I'm thinking that I might have got some of the HTML or the CSS wrong, but let's just double check our work. It doesn't seem right. Yeah, I might have to redo that one. I mean, that is above, and we have the before. Now, I think it's because my CSS is a little different than what I've done on a different example. Let's just double check that. Yeah, I kind of like this one better. So let's go back to the CSS. Let's just check this out. Probably going to use variables this time. Let's go ahead and define some variables at the other container level. Okay, so then the dragger. In my notes, they're opposite order, so I'm having to, I could probably just rearrange to make it a little bit easier in my head. So yeah, the before here. Turn that music down a little bit. I don't know if it's loud for you guys or not, but it's pretty loud for me. Yeah, not seeing it, really. All right. So then the other before, we have content, we have absolute position. This one, we have our constraint offset. This one, also the constraint offset. That one's fine. I could probably change these so that it's more customizable, but for now I'm not going to. Dragger size. And the dragger itself. Let's do the border first. Which again, I should probably pull this out as a variable, but I'm not gonna worry about that right now. Let's force it an inline block, border radius, 50%. Wait a second, am I doing that? Yeah, I'm in the right place. Cursor pointer. Position absolute, Z index. All right, width is going to be dragger size. Dragger size. I'll probably split those out into multiples. Then top, zero, left, zero. So yeah, this one makes a little bit more sense because the dragger is actually inside of the constraint box. Yeah, that could work. So let's come back over here. Let's run the prepare package again. That way it updates the other CSS. I don't know if there's a quicker way to do this. I know that I could probably call the goal directly. Let's take a look at this one and the other goal. Is for minify, and right now it's on the prepare package. I could probably change this to just temporarily change this to like a different phase, like prepare resources or generate resources. I'm not sure if anything happens before that. Yeah, let's try that. Generate resources. Because that's all we're doing here. We're not actually doing anything else. We're just wanting the minification to occur. Yeah, that's so much faster without the other compile. Much better. All right, let's come over here, refresh. And again, we'll probably have to do this twice because the public CSS, it has to be compiled, so to speak. But then we have to refresh and kill the other resources. I haven't been able to get that in a single refresh yet. Yeah, see, that's still the old one. Okay. So that's a little bit better. And let's go ahead and inspect that. Yes, that is a terribly large dragger. But it might be fine. It might be fine. Let's figure this out together. So yeah, this container, we probably need to set a height. Let's just do 50 pixels for now. And let's go ahead and overflow flip. So we're gonna have to run that a couple of times. And so that I don't accidentally commit that change, I am going to move that into a new change list. No commit. And that is not active. There we go. I just don't want to accidentally commit that because I just changed the other life cycle, only for to make this a little bit faster. All right, so then the container itself, I can make a height of 50 pixels. I can make overflow hidden. So let's go ahead and do that here too. That way we can actually see it. Yeah, see, now it is flipping that, which is perfect. And I probably need to have this as a different color. Might be nice. Let's get the container as a whole. Let me put a border on this. Pixel solid red. That way we can actually see it whenever we're moving through the others. Oh, thanks for the other follow, Skipper Undercover. Really appreciate the follow. Hey, how's it going today? That looks correct. The constraint is a little bit off. Need to look at that. So margin left is the constraint offset, which is, oh, I need this to be positive, not negative. So it's like I need a calc negative one times that. Yeah. That one's not that great. Where am I from? New England. I'm up near the Boston area. Yeah, that seems a little off. I need the margins. For the background, I probably need a like a 50% top. So I don't have a top right now, only to put it in the center. But that's not going to be the 50%. We need like 50% minus half of the height, right? Minus 6 pixels, and that's going to be calc. And that'll actually do the centering. Kind of lost track of all of the changes that I made, so I should probably do that now. So the constraint. No, that was the slider background. So the top is going to be calc 50% minus half of that variable, right? When at height, I need a variable for this. Matters on these, but Let's go ahead and make the order matter. All right, so then we have the other component height, and this is going to be 50% minus calculating the half of the height. So that is how the top is going to be calculated. Let's take a look at this constraint again. I'm not sure if I need a margin left and margin right. Got the padding. I might have to play around with those numbers. So I had them in there for a reason. I cannot recall. Let me remove that calc out of there back to what it was before. Because I think isn't my padding the same? Where's the other constraint box? So constraint offset. So it's not the same as gutter size. My gutter size is 8 pixels. Constraint offset is negative. Oh, so I actually do have that. I think that was just so that I can have the padding. I don't know why I had it like that. Now let me make that disappear. Let me just double check my my drag handle. So I have my before content empty, position absolute, constraint offset, order radius 50%. Is the back end already done? There's no back end on this. This is just creating a widget today, being able to create a color picker. The end goal is to have something similar to this right here, where you have color picker, hue selector, hue picker, and being able to do this, and all as a single component. And what that component's going to look like, I don't know. It might be a button. Sort of like, I don't know. I think there's some examples in art programs where it'll have like a button. It could be like in a Google Drive document. And I don't want to open up Google Drive on screen. So let me do that in a separate window. Let me create a new document. There we go. Brand new document. Yeah, my mouse cursor is just lagging. Can't I snap this in here? Oh, there we go. So if I had like a text color button, for example, I would be able to create that and it would pop up. I don't really like this color picker. That color picker is kind of gross. I mean, I do like the ability to, that's kind of cool. Actually goes outside of the browser window. I wonder how that does that. I'm going to have to look at that. Let's see if I can do a color picker that actually goes outside of the browser window. How does it do that? I like that. Yes, so it would bring up something like this. That's kind of what, yeah, and that's kind of what I'm wanting is some sort of drop down with a color picker, being able to select the color, comes up with the hex, RGB values, the HSV value, etc. But first things first, because this is a composite component, this is the end goal, but I might want to start out with this smaller component in here first, and then just compose multiple components into the larger one. So that's what I'm doing right now. Right now I'm just working on the CSS for it, being able to at least have this stuff in a viewable structure. Yeah, so this should work. I just think I have my dragger wrong. Let me rerun that CSS real quick. Make sure that it has my latest changes, because I kind of lost track of what CSS I was making in the browser. Let's see if I can empty cache and reload without having to do the rest of it. But I think because they're public, if I take a look at the network tab, you can see that all of that stuff has already been sent to the browser before the compile step. So I have to refresh it again to get the latest update after the GWT compile. Yeah, that completely changed. Can you explain what modals are? Oh. This was just from a previous project that I was working on. This was just creating some bug fixes or some additional extensions to Domino UI. And modals are just the windows. And I think with this one, I was just trying to reproduce a bug just for a bug report. So if we go to GitHub Domino UI, we'll be able to see some of the issues. And I think it was, yes, pop-ups. This one, yeah, this one's not actually modal because of the fact that I can interact with the stuff behind it. This one's not modal. At least that's my definition of modal. I think there is a component in here, or yeah, maybe not. It may have been closed in a recent change. Resizing window. That could have been it. I don't know which bug I was working on. I probably should have put a note on that one. The data table, this one I was just working on providing a live grid, so the ability to load like 5,000 records in the this grid without killing the other browser. Same with 50,000 records. So if I were to load that, you can see that it's not killing the browser. It's not loading all of these rows as HTML elements. It's basically creating a live view. So whenever I'm scrolling, you can see that new records are being added to the bottom. And all of the ones that I'm scrolling away from, they basically get removed from the other DOM. Way we're not killing the other browser heap. So that works out pretty well. But I haven't contributed that one up yet. Eventually. But yeah, this one I'm just working on a color picker. So that is the current goal. I get sidetracked on projects quite a bit, to be honest. All right, so my constraint box, let me go ahead and add that border again. Should probably just add that border in the code here. Just temporary. Yep. Sure, 1 pixel solid red. That way we can see it later. So the constraint, need to get rid of the margin, I think. trying to figure out why I have the margin, because that just doesn't line up anymore. Let's remove that margin. Yeah, see, well, technically, I guess the slider background should be within the constraint area too. Yeah, I might have to change that a little bit, because I was thinking that it would be outside, but I think it might have to be on the inside. Not entirely sure what the use of the constraint box would be then. If I were to move this to inside of this constraint. Oops, not preceding it. I want it to be moved here. Yeah, see, let me move that dragger to the right a little bit. 50 pixels. Yeah, this way, whenever I have zero, this dragger will be all the way to the left and basically grab the zero part of that slider. So yeah, I might end up having to do that. Yeah, let's do that. So let's move in the hue picker. Let's put the slider background inside of the other constraint box as well, which honestly, we don't really need the constraint box anymore if you think about it. I'm trying to think of why we need the constraint box in this particular case. I think I was just being consistent with the HSV picker, since that one does need the constraint box. Let's take a look at this real quick. I might get rid of that. Let me see what kind of code I had for the constraint box. Yeah, that one I used specifically for the drag and drop to make sure that we didn't leave the constraint element. I might actually keep it, but move this one inside. Let's see how that works out. What framework is that? Depends on which one we were talking about. To be able to write Java code for the other browser, that's GWT or GWT. But the library for the widgets is Domino UI. So here's the demo for it. Yeah, paste that URL. We also have the GitHub project with all of the getting started guides. And this is just for GWT and Jekyll, J2CL. Basically, ability to write Java code for the other browser. Calculated wrong because this constraint is not constraining that. This one position, oh, that's position absolute as well. Come on, get back out there. Maybe I can just undo. I just want to undo that move. There we go. Got it back out there. That did not fix it. Yeah, I think the CSS is broken because I've made too many changes. Yeah, I might keep it like that. Oops, I need to move that back. I can just change the CSS appropriately for that. So I'm just gonna keep that on the outside. That'll make it a little bit easier. Refresh that again. I probably do need to... I already got rid of the margins for the left and right. That is not working. Oh, that's right, because I never regenerated it after I've modified the CSS. I didn't concatenate and reminify it. Because I did add that red border around it all. And again, we're going to have to refresh twice because the first one's going to be the compilation and the second one just to grab the brand new copy of that minified CSS. There we go. Yeah, that still didn't vertically align this one. Here's a constraint, slider background. That should... Component height. Isn't that what I did before? Component height, 50 pixels. If I just do like 0.5 times that. I know that I'm nesting aux. Let me just see if it supports. I don't think it supports very complex calculations. No. Oh, that's right. That's not the right height that I was looking for. It's the height of the track. Let me create a track height. And this one is 12 pixels. Yeah, this is half the track height. Not half of the total height. That'd be weird. Because I'm basically doing 50% minus 50%, which is going to be zero. Gnome. And I should have probably used the track height variable here. Again. Okay, so that should fix that vertical height. Of course, I'm not sure if I need that outside of the constraint now, but that's fine. We will deal with the extra issues later, I think. For example, why... Let me change the top of this a little bit. That might actually be correct. Just wanting to make sure that it's an empty hole. Yeah, Yeah, it is. Okay. I don't like the color of it. I'll change that later. And I should probably change that now, shouldn't I? So this is going to be... Oops, red. Nope. That's gross. That's probably good. We'll change styles later. So white. And again, this should be probably configurable. Accidentally overwrote my variable there. It's just B7s. All right, so then the trigger itself. Constraint dragger, this is absolute position inside of that. I wonder if I should do margins instead of... What if I did margins instead of padding? Yeah, that might be better. Of course, that makes it really gross. Isn't there a margin top for this? Let's just do a top. This is going to be var dragger size. Nope. Dragger size? Yeah. Again, I'm just getting into the weeds here. So let's see here, dragger, so the top, going to be fair, gutter. And this will all have to change once we support different orientations, vertical versus horizontal. But I would like to be able to get at least a large portion of this done before I break for lunch today. Because a lot of it's going to be investigating how the drag and drop's going to work. Probably should look at some of the other components to see what other drag and drops there are. Because I think there is a slider, isn't there? Yeah, a slider. Yeah. So I am going to... Probably off stream. Look at how the sliders work. I mean, heck, we could have probably used this. Because it's basically just a slider, right? But the background, the track is going to be the color gradient. Here's a an RGB picker with the sliders like that. I don't know. I might look at that. Sliders with colors. I forgot about this component being there. Yeah, the background color is just going to be a little bit more complicated since the background color needs to be this long linear gradient. Does this support vertical? don't think so. Doesn't show vertical sliders. Oh well, this is just a good demo though to see how all of this is going to work. I'll make that decision later. But we want to, yes, I'm making a color picker, very similar to the one in Chrome. So it's going to be a composite where we're going to have this hue picker, possibly an alpha picker, and a HSL picker. And that's going to be composited into a single component. And then we can wrap that with like a menu, just as it is here, so that we can have any kind of button that can bring up that value, and it'll have the change events, stuff like that. I am not entirely sure how to get rid of that window. Escape, there we go. All right, so let's take a look at the Java source for this. I am not sure how much we want to get into like editors. I don't know if Domino does that or not. Let's take a look at like the abstract value box. Which is a value box. Basic form element. Sure if I need basic form element or not. I could just change the superclass at some point, but it's not exactly a form element. It does have support for GUID editors. Not seeing that though. Unless it's further down in the type hierarchy. We have abstract value box. How does it do the editors then? Because shouldn't it be implementing like a leaf value editor or something like that? Focusable has placeholder, read only. Yeah, I'm not seeing where that would be. Let's put all of this stuff over here. Form element. Oh, it's actually in the element itself. Basic form element. Guess I didn't go high enough. Man, I might have to reboot before I start streaming again. Lord. Am I like doing a backup right now or something? Where is my capsule? Nope. My machine's not backing up right now. I'm not entirely sure. Implements form element as input element. Ah, there it is. So leaf value editor. This has grouping. I'm just not sure which parent class I actually want to choose on this one. Should I do the basic form element? What does this one do? Some helper text. Error labels. I am not sure how to do an error label on this. I mean, I could always just implement it directly for now. Yeah, let me just implement it directly for now. A different has value. All right, so let's implement those methods. All right, has value. Oh, needs two. It's a little different than the GWT has value. Or the values here, type and value, maybe? Type of the class implementing this interface. Takes value. Let me take a look at the has value. Where did I get that one before? Yeah, the GWT has value. Yeah, right here. If I didn't use that has value and I use this has value, because this one extends takes value. Why can I not see that? Ow. It's just because I'm not extending that. Probably because Domino UI isn't directly using the GWT UI stuff. Yeah, let's take a look at that. Implement takes value, has value. And this is which one again? All right, so I guess I can do that one. How's that any different? Do that then. Now I want the domino one this time, and then takes value integer. Let's redo these methods. Oh, and that's the reason why to use the domino UI has value and takes value is because it uses the builder pattern. Yeah, that makes sense. All right, so let's go ahead and create some of this crap. That's my root. Put some of my fields in here. I probably want a change Let's change handlers. All right, so get value. Let's return value. So let's go through and implement these. This.value equals value. I'm gonna have to double check the value method in here. Oops. Value. Alright, so this one does delegate. Just for uniformity. Set value is probably just calling value on that value. I'll probably eventually extend one of these classes. I don't know. I just don't need the validation and stuff whenever it's just a draggable component. Special for this. Yeah, maybe I'll just do that. Hearing this vibrating sound, I'm not sure where that's coming from. I think it's my NAS. Obviously, in the value method down here, we're going to actually update the UI appropriately. Yeah, we'll probably do like update view. We'll probably do something in here. I guess I could take a look at the slider component. Let's just cheat a little bit. So this is actually doing all of that. Value. What is the thumb value? That is a span. All right. So here's the event listeners for the drag stuff. So you have your down, move, leave, and up. That. Oh, I see. So this is handling a touch as well, which is probably not a bad idea. Do that again. I probably could just change this to use the other slider, just have to change the other background. What if I were to do that? Let me check out this background. And let's just copy the value. And let's inspect this guy. Oops. This lag is just killing me. I haven't dropped too many frames at least. That in. Yeah, I mean, that could work. I changed them all, didn't it? Not too bad. I might end up doing that. Because it already has all of the stuff for it. What does this extend? Yeah, base domino element. So basically did the same thing as me. It didn't implement the has value or takes value, which is fine. It also, this isn't a leaf, so this isn't an editor object. Yeah, we'll see. I like to do things the hard way first, and then we can narrow it down later what is actually beneficial. All right, so the maximum value is going to be 360, so it is a range from 0 to 360, technically 359. We might actually support 360. So maybe what I want to do, I might want to pull these out, So I need the dragger as a separate object. I might do a final domino element, HTML div element, dragger equals. And it's basically this guy right here. Shouldn't need access to any of the other stuff. I wouldn't think. Might have to have access to the other constraint object, but I could just get that through the parent of the other dragger itself. All right, so then if we were to set a value, I'm not sure if we need to check to see if we're attached or not. Last time I wrote one of these, it was back whenever I was writing Cincha widgets, so dealing with like the attached information was beneficial. So move thumb. Yeah. So for the other view, probably need some data types here, like HSV, because it would be nice to be able to change the thumb, or the, I know that is called thumb over here, but over here I called it dragger. I should probably be consistent if I'm going to contribute this, but if I take a look, I don't know if this does it or not. This one doesn't, but it might actually be beneficial to change the color of the dragger. I don't know. We can probably just keep it the same color for now. I'm gonna go through and change all of these later, because I'm gonna have to update the CSS as well. Possibly. Notes. So this one, we should probably not update the dragger or the thumb if it's currently dragging, but we don't have those events set in yet. So for the time being, I'm just going to set the left. This value times the track width. Divided by the hue max. And is that a string? Yeah, that is a string. So that'll have to be pixels. Of course, I did the calculate range offset. Might as well do that. just in case that needs to be changed later. And for the other track width, I could probably just grab the information from the user interface. See, I need to figure out, it's probably going to be the size of, probably the constraint box. So thumb, parent. Oh wait, it's because it's just an element, not an HTML element. No, it's a div. I should probably just keep these out, otherwise, what's the point? All right, so let's, changing all this over again. Should probably just create all of these as final fields and then put them all together inside of the other constructor. That would probably be a little bit better because it looks like crap here. That's fine. Get that. So for any object, I should be able to get the constraint or the set width. So I guess that's the other thing. I don't know if I want to get the offset width that way. Change that back to track width. Because this one will have to be calculated as well. This is like grabbing I don't know why I wrote it that way. So we have the thumb bounds, and this is the thumb can go from 0 to total width minus dragger or thumb width. See, and that's where I need to figure out, like, where is the zero, where is the value going to be? Is it going to be from here to a little bit before the end, like in the center of the thumb? Probably makes sense to do it that way. Or is it on the other left side? Because obviously it's the other left side. Well, I guess it doesn't really matter. Because whenever I'm doing the other left, it needs to be constrained between zero and the width of that dragger, right? So then the calculate is basically going to be this dot value times get track width. I know that I have it right there. Divided by hue max. Okay, we can test that. If I can actually open this back up, refresh, make sure that there's no errors in the other code. All right, so those no errors. So what we want, let's set a value to it. So in my demo, I have the hue picker here, and I want to do value and 210. Let's see what that does. Of course, there might be some contention on where this calculation is going to be done in the other chain, because I'm actually setting that and it's not actually, it's calling update view whenever it hasn't even been attached yet. So how does it do it over here on the other slider side? Move thumb. Let's look at the two places. Read only. So that's a mouse up event. Evaluate thumb position, but only if the mouse is down. Maybe I'm looking at this the wrong way. Curious, if I were to put a slider in here, The pen child slider.create. Oh, max value 360. Let's just use the same values. And let's do the value, value of 210. Okay, apparently it's not set. There we go. Oop, set value to 10. Suppose I could have done a has a relationship to create my hue picker. But again, the current slider doesn't support vertical orientation, and I would like to get that. So that actually does work. Oh, this is setting the value. That's not actually a bad idea. So how does the get value work? Oh, we can do that. So what is this element? Okay, let's do that. Instead of using a field, let's be consistent with Domino. So this isn't going to have a value. Look for all of the places that's broken now. So this is going to be the thumb. Oh, that's the slider. I think it's using container. So the slider is probably a different place. Is that the track? So that's creating an input range. Well, let's take a look at it HTML wise. So this is putting everything inside. I mean, obviously everything is inside the row, or this root container. Thought this was the thumb. That is a thumb, but it's not this thumb. That's actually an error. That should not be allowed. It should be name equals, because that violates the contract of HTML. If I have multiple sliders, we can't have multiple IDs with the same value. Oh, that's kind of interesting. I guess I could just throw this on anything, but it kind of makes sense to have like an input. All right, so let's do that. Where would we put that? Probably the constraint. The constraint box could be an input. Run, import. I think I have to do a domino element of. And I'm going to construct it outside of here. Instead of constraint box, I might change this one to being a slider. Yeah, maybe I'll do this one as the slider. Then the constraint box is going to contain the thumb. Yeah, I have my organization a little bit different. And this one is going to be the slider. I'm just going to do that one the same way as before. Constraint box, we have our thumb, we have our slider. Constraint box, why is that having a problem? Yeah, I'll probably use the constraint box somewhere in here. All right, so down here, is using a double. Yeah, I don't think I need to do a double for the hue because it can't actually be a double. Guess I'm just gonna have to do a double value of int value. Does this not have a value directly on it? Where's the other slider? So this domino element, it's a container. Guess not. Why? Ow. Yeah, that probably makes more sense. Let's get down here. That's fine. All right. So for the range. Zero max. Would be max. Let's see if that has any problems. Get a little obsessive compulsive whenever it comes to writing widgets. I need to back up a little bit now. I guess because this is a range, it's going to have a different style. I thought I'd be able to do the other background that way. Looks like I would have to change this pseudo, because it does have a shadow root. Oh, that's why. Okay, I get it. This is actually using the HTML input range for the slider, and I was implementing it manually. It's not terrible. But I don't want to do it that way. So, guess I can just turn that back. Does this have the ability to grab the value from it? I know it does, but yeah, 99. 47. Huh. I could always make this one invisible. Display block. Oh wait, hidden. None. How can I do that? Because I basically just, I don't want its shadow root. Types do I have? Because we still have the other value on here, which is coo. Actually be an interactable input. I just want it to hold a value. And I don't want hidden because then I can't style it. I guess I can do it that way. Just a separate element for the slider, the range. Yeah, let's do that. Is this for hidden? Does it use the display or visibility? Hidden. Does that actually work? Must be a global style for that. All right, so then the other slider and child slider background. Doesn't really matter because that one's not displayed. It's only in the HTML to put a value in the HTML instead of a field. I might do something with it later. Yeah, it's not hidden. I thought that the display would have worked. Display. How do I do the display? Yes, it wasn't supported in the input element, but it is for the domino element. That way it's fully customized. And we got to figure out the drag and drop, because apparently this drag and drop with the other slider was actually relying upon the other range input element. Ours is gonna have to be a little different. All right, so let's do that. Just create a draggable. What does Domino provide in regards to dragging? Because the draggables over here. This was like drag zones and drop targets. Yeah, drop zone, drag source. So drag source is a representation of this object, I believe. Well, I mean, it's not representation of a single element. Basically, we're adding the draggables to that drag source. We have two draggable elements. Yeah, that's not entirely what I want. This is removing it and adding it as a child to the drop area. But I mean, something's listening to the drag events, right? Let me take a look at the drag source. Defines draggable elements. Each drag source has its list of draggable elements. Can be dragged and dropped. Yeah, that's not really helpful. Yeah, I was hoping that I know that there's a draggable inside of GXT. Let's see if I can find the other code for that, or not the code, but GXT Java Dog. GXT for API, doesn't really matter which one. There is a draggable package. That is not right. That's theme. I think it may have been under FX. Yeah, here we go. Here's the draggable. So this adds the drag behavior to any widget. This is kind of what I was hoping for, because you would have your widget inside the draggable, and within that you would be able to specify its container. So you can, if you specify the container, specifies the container to which the drag widget is contained, which is exactly what we need to be able to restrain where we can drag this component, so that we're not dragging it outside of the other container. Well, let's see if we can do this. Would be nice if I had a if we had a draggable utility, because I kind of need this for the HSL picker as well. Because whenever we come in here, we'll need to be able to drag inside of this area as well, and it needs to be constrained. So I might create a draggable class inside of this package. Yeah, this one's not going to be very fun, because we need to be able to apply some events to it and have it listen to global events so that it would know. Because even though you're doing the drag, notice that whenever I'm on, I may have to reboot sooner than later. My mouse is just not following. Whenever I'm dragging, notice that because of the lag right now of my computer, which I still don't know why, the element that I'm dragging is falling behind the cursor. In HTML, with the JavaScript, if I were to have a mouse move event and stuff like that, it can't be within that element, because as soon as you leave that element, it's no longer going to be receiving those events. I need to be receiving the mouse move at the browser level. Otherwise, you would have to move very slowly and hope that the element stays within your cursor Otherwise, it would not move and follow. So I might end up having to do that at a later time. So what I can do, because that's not going to be fun, that's going to be a lot of math and stuff. I need to find the best way of implementing this draggable to handle domino components. But we are well underway of being able to create this hue picker. Let's at least get it so that we don't have the interactivity, but I would like for it to actually set its left location. So before we end the stream, I would like to do that. And maybe next time we'll start working with the draggable. So let's go back to this hue picker. And I kind of need an attach event. And I cannot recall. Oh, I never did the init. What was I missing with that? Style initializer. Okay, not a whole lot, but probably a good idea to do that. And down here, I guess I can because of the fact that, that's not working. Let me just do it this way. It's the same element. All right. Let's refresh. See if that changed anything. I don't think it will. Because I think we still need to have some sort of event that occurs after we've displayed. How do we do that? Is there any kind of attach listeners? That's the only way to do it beforehand. In the update view, because this is getting called, the problem is that the bounding rectangles don't have a size yet. It's basically going to have a zero width until it's actually added to the user interface. Oops, did not mean to do that. Show listener. I don't think it has an event. I think it's just a callable debut. Let's see what that does. So then anytime it's shown, I'm assuming this is after it's shown, we will update the other view. Need either a breakpoint or some sort of logging in there to let us know that we've been in here. Be able to trace that. Well, it did call, but again, we're not actually attached. Because if I were to root element parent, that should be, or parent node, that should be null. I just want to print out the other parent just to make sure that it's not attached. See, it's null. So is there any super class methods for this lifecycle? Like an on. Oh, there is a unattached. On now or now or when attached? What does that do? Oh, that's just for a handler registration. Oh, so that probably means instead of a show listener, now or when attached. Can that happen? If I should do a like a requesting an animation frame or something like that. Okay, that time it worked. Okay, so that does work. Should probably put a change listener. On the slider itself, because this is the input element, add change. No, add. Event listener. And this is going to be event type change. That's going to take an event, so then we just do like an update view. Just out of curiosity if that works, because then we can change the value directly on that input element, and it'll also update the other view. That might cause. We're gonna have to figure that out. I'm wondering if that'll cause some sort of infinite loop. All right, there's the arrange object. So if I do value equals 120. Oh, that didn't change the other value, or it didn't call the update. What other event types do we have? Thought it would be change. So we're not actually receiving any of those other. I wonder if it's because the display is none. Wonder if that's going to cause it a problem. So let me revert that back to change. Sometimes the display none. Oh, I don't want that anymore. Let's just what the heck did I just do? All right, so this is going to overlay, which is fine. It's just to test to see if that change event is actually getting fired whenever I'm modifying the value directly. Okay, so it is changing the value, but for some reason the change event's not firing. Let me go back here. Let's take a look at the other range. Does support orient. That's interesting. So if I put orient equals vertical, does that work? Doesn't look vertical. Get rid of that. Yeah, it's non-standard, so it might not work. Firefox, I don't know. Change an input. All right. So add event listener, and let's do input. Input didn't work. Is it not bound to the value? I mean, whenever I do this, can I drag that? That orient. Don't know if that caused any issues. Why can't I click on that? Probably because it's behind the other box. Z index 5. Let's just make sure it's. Oh, can't do Z index on an input. Yeah, that's fine. Huh. Well, let's make this one display none. Display none. There we go. It was just laying on top. Well, that is getting called. So those are input events and a change event whenever it finishes. But it seems to only be doing it with interaction. Yeah, I'm hitting the left arrow. Really only doing it with interaction. I can't come here and set the other value. How do you trigger a change event and changing a value? So that's just the initial value of the control. That's weird. Yeah, I mean, that's what I would have thought. So it can be changed, but it's not firing the change event. I know this is a terrible search. Yeah, that's what I want. Yeah, I don't care about IE. So we have to dispatch the event manually. Okay, that's fine. Just buyer beware if you're modifying this directly. Dispatch event, new change event. What was it? Oops. New event change. Duh. It's been a while since I've done this. Okay, yeah, that does work. All right, so let's ignore all of that little rabbit hole that I was going down. All right, so setting the display to none doesn't impact it whatsoever. It's just that it's not going to actually fire the event until you dispatch it. Yeah, I still want that log. All right, so let's just try that again. All right, so there's that. Let me get back to that input. Let's set the value to like 55, and then let's dispatch it, and there we go. So that does actually work. I'd like to probably change the color of that, but I think we need to have some data types, because we're gonna eventually need like RGB, HSV data types. I don't think we have any RGB. Oh, we got RGB color. That does, it's not a smart object, but RGB color is not that bad. That doesn't extend anything or implement any interfaces. What does Domino have? It does have color. Looks like a lot of... So it looks like color is just a constant. That's creating a new color, but it's manual. Yeah, and these are just the other style names. That's not entirely what I want. I mean, it's nice for what it is, but that's not what I'm needing. So I probably do need to create a color type, an HSV type, an RGB type. That way I can encapsulate all of the calculations, because we need to be able to convert from HSV to RGB and vice versa. I don't know if I need a color right now. Maybe, because if I want to do like a static method for HSV of, I can take a color. They have a common. Super type. And this will be HSV. And I'll probably have like an HSL. Any of the other color related classes. Because we will need to be able to do this. And that was mainly because I wanted to be able to change the color of the thumb to basically match whatever color is in there. So a couple of things that we're going to do for the next stream. We're going to work on the events. I'm going to look at some options that we have for creating a draggable, making sure that it's constrained to an element. And then we're also going to look at some of the other data types that we're going to introduce with this color picker, because we will need to be able to have this as an editable of HSV or whatever. So. I am going to call it for today. I've been streaming for almost 3 hours. I think that's probably good. Time. 2 hours, 49 seconds. That's fine. 2 hours, 49 minutes. I don't know why I said seconds. Going to grab some lunch. If I come up with something for this afternoon, I might be back. Otherwise, I'll probably just be here tomorrow. So I hope you enjoyed the stream. Everybody on YouTube, just keep an eye out for the next one, where we're going to be covering the drag and drop and possibly some of the other color manipulation calculations. So stay tuned. Thanks a lot.